Sheila, and thank you also VP Peng for the warm welcome. First, let me share with our audience that the main motivation for this study is that the previous Philippine Development Plan, the PDP 2017-2022, assessed that despite the previous investments on improvement and expansion projects, the transport infrastructure of the country is inadequate. Thus, the PIDS scrutinized the underlying reasons for this, specifically for road and rail sectors, water transport sector, and air transport sector. So we're presenting today only the results for road and rail, which I studied together with Mr. Jokkaz Latigar, or Jokkaz. And we hope that you will also take time to read the studies for the water and air transport sectors done by Dr. Chris Abrigo, available in our website. Next slide, please. Let me outline the flow of our presentation. So Jokkaz will present the current state of the stock and quality of our road and rail infrastructure and some issues. Then I will present our analysis of the challenges in the planning, programming, and implementation stages. And then I will present the derived policy insights. Let me now turn you over to Jokkaz. Jokkaz.
Hello. Magandang hapon po sa atin lahat. First of all, thank you so much, Dr. Navarro, for the introduction. And thank you also to Dr. CR and VP Ballesteros for the preliminaries. Before I start, I would also like to acknowledge my co-RA at PIDS, Mr. Jetho Camara, for his invaluable research assistance in this study. So to start, now I guess it's fair to assume that one way or another, we all have experience commuting via public transportation, no? Whether via train, buses, jeepneys, taxis, tricycles, etc. No? And some of the long standing issues that always emerge when we talk about land transportation is traffic or congestion. No? And in the case of trains, long queues. So now, these of course are observations from our experiences. These are data that direct us toward issues that are more entrenched than they appear to be. Now, with that, I will be presenting the results of our study from the review of quantitative data from international and government sources, as well as from the gathering of qualitative data from focus group discussions and key informant interviews with implementing agencies. So next slide, please. Okay, let's start with roads, no, the national and local roads. So the DPWH has a road classification system. So based on that, the national roads are composed of the primary, secondary, and tertiary, while the local roads, provincial, municipal, city, and barangay roads. No, essentially, national roads are funded and managed by DPWH, while local roads by local governments. Now, the data shows, no, that in 2021, the country's road network has a total length of more than 205,000 kilometers. No, hati na yon between national roads and local roads. Now, the figures for the national roads of more than 34,000 kilometers is already inclusive of the national bridges or mga tulay. Now, according to DPWH bridge management system, we have more than 8,000 bridges which measure more than 300,000 linear meters. On the other hand, the data for local roads were estimated from our FGDs and KIIs kasi wala silang readily available for that. No, that's more than 170,000 kilometer with the following disaggregation. Now you can see on your screen for the type of local roads. Unfortunately, there are also no available data for the local bridges, no, because the LG's inventory is not yet complete in the time of writing the study. So that's the snapshot of the total stock of our roads. No? Now, when we look at trends for national roads, the time series data from 2007 to 2021 will show that there actually is a gradual increase in terms of length. No? From 2007, more than 29,000 kilometer lang siya, it grew to more than 34,000 kilometer in 2021. So there are several reasons for that. No? There are conversion of road sections, improvement of gap sections, and completion of flyovers, no, etc. Okay, so ano ngayon? No, what's the significance of these aggregate figures on us, to us? No, one useful indicator that can help us appreciate it is through road density. So what do we mean by road density? It is the ratio of the total length of the road network to a specified land area. So the premise is that may correlation ang high road density with highly developed areas. Why? Now, because a well-developed road transport sector paves the way for the creation of market access opportunities, especially for agricultural goods. Now, it facilitates economic activities and the ease of mobility for social services. So the data shows now that there is a gradual increase of nationwide road density over the years. That in 2021, there's 10.68 kilometers of roads per 100 square kilometer of land. But of course, this national average does not tell us a complete story, because when we look at regional road densities, they are actually remain low, lower than the national average, which could indicate weak connectivity sa mga regional areas natin, which of course could hamper some national development. So we've discussed the stock or the quantity of roads and bridges. Now the next slide will display some of the key findings on the quality of these infrastructure. Okay, so our study found that the quality for both the national roads and national bridges, the first two bullets you see on your screen, have actually been improving over the years. So the indicator for quality improvement is the surface type or the type of construction material used. So we want our roads to be paved, gawa sa concrete or asphalt, as compared to gravel or earth. We want also our bridges to be permanent, gawa sa concrete and steel as compared to bailey and timber. So we see from the data that the length of paved roads have been increasing. So in 2021, there are more than 32,000 kilometers of paved national roads. So that's 98.66% of national roads. Same with permanent bridges, increasing din siya. Total of more than 386,000 linear meters or 99.71% of national bridges. Also in 2021. However, may caveat. Now we need to highlight that since national roads play critical roles in connecting major economic centers such as cities, provincial capitals, airports, seaports, and tourism centers to each other, it follows that the presence of unpaved roads, gravel, and earth roads in 2021 would actually mean that crucial quality improvements are still needed to be done. Kasi as this could weaken connectivity. Kasi we're not only concerned about aggregate length, but also about the connectivity of this infrastructure. Another thing, local roads are not yet included in these figures. It's a whole different story for the majority of local roads, because ang unpaved sa mga local roads is at 56%, so more than half. And according to a 2017 municipal roads inventory of another PIDS study, there is a large gap in the paving of municipal roads, where 47.42% of the total roads from the submit data are still unpaved. Okay, so we have increasing length of paved national roads and permanent national bridges. However, again, having paved roads does not always mean having roads that are in good condition. So the DPWH conducts a visual road condition survey annually. So through this assessment, roads and bridges are categorized based on the treatment and maintenance measures they need. So may categories na good, fair, poor, bad. The good means that little to no maintenance required, only the routine maintenance. And the data shows that in 2021, only 41.22% of paved national roads and 51.03% of national bridges can be considered to be under good condition. So less than half and a little more than half. So the quality of roads, especially local roads, is crucial in consideration to last mile connectivity. This, of course, has significant implication to the delivery of social services to these areas. So, all right, now that's for the roads and bridges. So in the next slide, I will present our findings on the rail sector. All right, the rail transport sector shows that in 2021, the country's rail network has 395 kilometers of operational routes with 87 stations and 889 train cars. So with that total, we have two rail systems. First is the Intra-Luzon Commuter Rail System owned and operated by the PNR. And the second, the Metro Manila Mass Rail Transit Systems. Both has three operating lines, as you can see in the screen. So to set the context for these figures, now we need to revisit the country's railway infrastructure in the 1970s when we have more than 1,000 kilometer railway length. Over the years, we witnessed a drastic drop in the number of regularly operating railway length that in 2016, we only have 77 kilometers. It is only in the recent years that the country began picking up. In 2021, that the total length increased to 395 as new investments and reopening of old routes, especially for the PNR lines, that expanded the existing network. So, and just a side note, there are no operational railway service for freight in the country currently. So this adds up to the problem, especially for roads leading to seaports and airports, because there are no other options but to ship via trucks, which can add to the congestion in those critical nodes and also to the quality concerns for roads carrying those heavy loads for the trucks. So that's for the supply side in rail sector. In the next slide, we will see what the demand side has to say. Okay, so in assessing the demand for rail services, one useful indicator is the performance of rail lines in terms of passenger traffic or passenger trips. So we have that on our screens. For PNR lines, the data shows that the average number of passengers per trip declined. This suggests that the decrease in the number of trips due either to cancellations or mobility restrictions during the pandemic, among others, or the drop in absolute number of passengers. Perhaps this can be also attributed to the commuters finding better alternatives to the PNR trains following the easing of pandemic-related restrictions in 2021. Anyway, on the other hand, the table below shows also the recent declines in passenger traffic for LRT 1, 2, and MRT 3. So you can observe from the highlighted cells that these declines started in 2018 and 2019, which was pre-pandemic. No? So we can attribute this to mobility restrictions. We will see later in Dr. Navarro's presentation that these data on passenger traffic and trips are crucial because it's one of the targets of the government for the railway sector codified in the PDP, which was to increase these figures. But as we see now, it actually declined. Next. So another related indicator is what you call the load factor. Now, load factor is the measure of capacity utilization of transport services like railways. So this is useful in assessing if a particular rail line is performing beyond its intended capacity. So we can use load factor to explain experiences related to congestion or long queues. Ganyan. To make sense of the table you have on your screen, of the graph you have on your screen, we have a benchmark in assessing the load factor. The target average is at 60%, meaning kung more than 60, most likely congested na or 60 ka na. So given that, we can see that the LRT1 and MRT3 exhibited above 60% load factors in most recent year most years recorded. On the other hand, LRT2 also started to exhibit load factors above 60% before the height of pandemic. So that years 2020 and 2021. So what can we conclude? Is that it validates or supports the commuters' experiences with congestion and long queues. Next slide. All right. So in relation to load factors for the Metro Manila rail lines, the PNR trains, on the other hand, also have similar experiences regarding performance and quality. But some of the issues are listed on your screen, such as congestion, poor quality, and unsafe railway platforms, train delays, and trip cancellations. So it only goes to show that for both the PNR and Metro Manila rail lines, there's still much to be done to address this weakness in quality. So after the presentation of within country assessment of road and rail status, the next slide will show a snapshot of a cross-country comparison. All right, so recent international data shows that the country's poor transport infrastructure is hurting our competitiveness. So this is according to the Global Competitiveness Index, or the GCI, of the World Economic Forum. So a little background on GCI, this 2019 iteration looked at 141 economies. So as indicators of global competitiveness, it assessed 12 pillars, no, and infrastructure is one of them. So the premise behind GCI is that these pillars are seen as the main drivers of productivity. And by productivity, we mean that the GCI treats productivity increase as the most important determinant of long-term economic growth. So aside from infra, we also have the pillars of ICT, health, skills, etc. No? Under the infrastructure pillar, there are two sub-pillars, transport and utilities. So what you see on your screen is the ranking of the Philippines among other ASEAN economies in terms of the transport sub-pillar. So as you can see, the country has the poorest showing in 2019. The number inside the square brackets above the bar charts, the 102nd, means that it is the ranking, the global ranking of the Philippines versus the 141 economies, pang 102 tayo. So this transport sub-pillar has 8 indicators, namely road connectivity, quality of road infra, railroad density, efficiency of train services, airport connectivity, efficiency of air transport services, liner shipping connectivity, and efficiency of seaport activity. So this sub-pillar not only includes road and rail sectors, but also water and air transport sectors. So what this international ranking show us is that we have much not to catch up on in terms of improving the quantity and quality of our road and rail infra. Now, to provide us the review of the achievement of the target set by the government in the Road and Rail Transport Infra Program, with consideration to the planning, programming, budgeting, and implementation linkages, I'm now turning over the virtual floor to Dr. Navarro. Mama Dora?
Yeah, thank you, Jokkaz. So what I will be presenting are the challenges. So I'll mention some of the achievements, but I'll focus more on the challenges. Okay, next slide, please. So in the stages of planning, programming, investment programming, and then budgeting and implementation. Okay, in terms of plan targets in the PDP, as assessed in the StatDev monitoring report, the targets are not met. Here we provide some examples with respect to the target in the road sector on road roughness index. Rather than improvement, what we have is deterioration from the baseline of 4.62 in 2015 to 4.68 in 2019. By the way, a road roughness index of 1 to 3 means good road condition, 3 to 5 means fair, 5 to 7 means poor, and greater than 7 means bad. So we remained in that poor category. Moreover, several regions have averaged road roughness index of greater than 5, which means that their roads are in poor condition. So these are Cordillera Administrative Region, Western Visayas Region, Zamboanga Peninsula Region, Davao Region, and Soccsaygen Region 12. So for the rail sector, there were targets on the train system optimal capacity, but these are not being reported by concerned agencies in the StatDev monitoring report that's supposedly for PDP target monitoring. So we have no way of knowing. Next slide. Target reduction in travel times were also not achieved. There were also cases when the targets are not helpful, such as oddly an increase in travel time in Metro Manila, which we are no longer showing here, but can be gleaned from the past PDP, the plan document in the previous administration. Target reduction in road accident rate is also not achieved. And then it's not reported in the monitoring reports, but the target increase in passenger trips via rail in Metro Manila was most likely not achieved given the decline in passenger traffic in recent years. In terms of policy targets, what's in the legislative agenda portion of the plan, these policy targets were also not achieved, specifically the enactment of a national transport policy and the creation of an independent regulatory body for railways. Next slide, please. Now let's go to the investment program. The program investments in the PIP or Public Investment Program 2017 to 2022, they're organized by thematic chapters. And in the 2021 update of that, the infrastructure investment program consisted of 5,586 projects with a total cost of 3,123 billion pesos. And among the infrastructure sectors, the transport sector had the highest share at 74.4%. However, the shares of the road and rail transport subsectors are not readily available. We attempted to request this actually from the NEDA central office, but the database given to us lack codes for the subsectors. So as there are 5,586 infrastructure projects in the database, now figuring out the subsector categorization based on the project titles alone would have been very time consuming. So we look at the flagship projects highlighted under the Build program. Now there are 42 road and rail projects in the updated list, and only four were completed by the end of the previous administration. So only four were completed. Let's look at the next slide. The overall investment targets, the one that I showed in the earlier slide, those targets are supposed to constitute the target public infrastructure spending of 7.4% of GDP by 2022. And as you can see in this graph, the trajectory of accomplishment based on actual disbursements from 2016 to 2021 shows that the 7.4% target may not have been achieved in 2022. In fact, for 2022, what was earmarked according to the DBM was only 5.3% of GDP. Okay, next slide, please. The agency's capacity to absorb and spend public funds remains a problem. So both DPWH and the DOTR continue to have a low absorptive capacity for funds, as you can see from the indicators, the yearly indicators that we're showing in this table. So their capacity to, their absorptive capacity in terms of ability to actually spend, no, deteriorated from 2016 to 2017. And then it remained low afterwards. So as delays in spending and payments suggest delays in the actual delivery of projects, it is important to examine what particular implementation challenges may have caused the delays, which is done in the discussion paper and summarized in the succeeding slides. Next slide, please. Okay, implementation challenges. We've always heard that the problem is implementation. No? That is, in the Philippines, that we have good policies, programs, and projects, but we often fail in the implementation of this. But what specifically are the implementation problems? So here's a deep dive on this. We uncovered the particulars through our desk research, focus group discussions, and key informant interviews. Some are persistent problems and some are newly introduced problems. First, the pandemic-related restrictions delay the right-of-way acquisition. This is a newly introduced problem, and it's a common problem in almost all regions as revealed in monitoring reports by the regional project monitoring councils. Also, delays in DBM fund release for items under the for later release category. This is also a problem that was not spoken of candidly before, at least in our experience in doing research. Although the delays in fund releases may not be new, the articulation of this happening in the for later release budget category was not talked about as candidly as before. And it is a well-known fact that during budget deliberations, legislators in their exercise of the power of the purse insert new budget items or expansion of certain proposed budget items, no, yung previously called congressional insertions, no, but now they're in some documents they're being referred to as congressional introductions kasi bawal na yung yung congressional insertion supposedly after a Supreme Court ruling on the pork barrel funds. So they often do this by reducing certain proposed budget items or entirely removing them. And that happens during the budget deliberation. So starting in fiscal year 2020, yung GAA item category for the congressional introductions, no, may additional requirement before the release of funds, the president's approvals. And in previous years, it had been enough that the president exercised his or her veto power to disapprove certain congressional introductions before signing the GAA. Then some delays happened in the for later release or FLR category, and this delayed the implementation activities. For example, in 2020, no, na-release daw in August lang, and then some were released as late as December 2020. And in some cases, funds released under the FLR mode were also not the full requirement. Like in the farm-to-market roads, no, almost half of the aggregate budget, no RDC endorsements though, and therefore later release funds. So that contributed to the delays. Okay, next are delays in improving road quality, that is paving, no, due to failure of some contractors to comply with the DPWH quality control program. So this is a quality control problem which can and must be solved on the ground. Next, many farm-to-market roads are still unpaved and disconnected due to erroneous practices. For example, before 2012, the construction of gravel and tire track farm-to-market roads or FMRs and having project length na as short as 100 meters, no, that was still allowed. Then to cover more geographic areas or to be able to distribute funds to more LGUs, FMR projects were then being split into short segments, so putol-putol. And then, therefore, the current differences in quality and the shortness of improved road segments made upgrading interconnectivity difficult, no? But in 2012, design standards for FMRs were issued, and which are now being used to fix the problem. Standard costing of a farm-to-market roads, FMR, at 12 million pesos per kilometer was also deemed not realistic. But I understand that talks have been held to raise the standard cost, and DPWH is addressing this. Political intervention in the finalization of the list of projects in the GAA is also present. There are projects in the National Expenditure Program that are being replaced by other projects during the GAA deliberation and the finalization process. Some of these congressional insertions do not undergo the usual due diligence process. Monitoring and evaluation. It's still not institutionalized. As of now, the DPWH monitoring is focused on performance governance scorecard only, and that still and at that stage of strengthening its M&E setup. There's also currently no specific office dedicated to conduct M&E, and it's the DPWH is still building the capacity of its regional and district offices on the importance of post-evaluation. Nevertheless, there are M&E processes for foreign assisted projects kasi these are required by ODA partners. The Mandanas-Garcilia ruling will affect the timely completion and the quality of infrastructure projects. And it actually, it's starting to affect. No? This is because of the lack of technical capability in some LGUs. No? There are provinces and municipalities which are still weak in procurement and even in construction supervision. The large gap in upgrading the quality of local roads due to numerous issues, no? That's also an implementation challenge. No? For example, the natural calamities, frequently occur. There are delays and the incomplete removals of obstructions in project sites, and there are difficulties in materials handling and manpower and supply chain problems. And these are these numerous problems were exacerbated during the height of the pandemic. Okay, next slide. The implementation challenges for rail projects naman. So right-of-way issues stalling the completion of projects no matter how early or efficient the other stages in project implementation were. So that's a main challenge. And we illustrate this using the MRT case, no? Problems in right-of-way acquisition in MRT-7 emerged in 2018. The acquisition of a 33-hectare lot in Bulacan for the MRT-7 train depot now reached the point when the OTR filed expropriation proceedings. Now, then the property owner questioned the expropriation in Malolos Regional Trial Court. No, then na move yung proposed right-of-way site to Quezon City rather than in Malolos Bulacan, Quezon City na. That was in 2019. However, the real estate company which owns the lot challenged naman the expropriation kasi the amount offered according to them was way below what was required by law. Then finally, last year, May 31, it was announced that a 20-hectare property in San Jose del Monte, Bulacan has been secured. Another challenge, no? Lack of consistency in decision-making. And that is, for example, due to changes in leadership and attendant legal disputes when original agreements are not honored. This is particularly true when politicians treat infrastructure projects as their political legacy, no? Although this problem is more frequent in LGU-level projects because of the shorter term for local chief executives na 3 years lang, no, for one term. Examples at the national level are also present, especially in the case of big ticket infrastructure projects. And one example that is often cited is yung construction of the unified Grand Central Station or the Common Station for MRT3. Okay, next slide. So let's look at the policy insights that we've derived, no? Our analysis of quantity and quality indicators nga, ha, as summarized by Jokkaz earlier, no, has shown that the Philippines continues to suffer from inadequate and poor quality of road and rail infra, no. And then we digging deeper, our discussion paper finds persistent as well as newly introduced implementation problems, no. So what are the derived policy insights? First, planning for the long term can help address the persistent problems. No? A long-term national transport infrastructure plan that is legislated can improve the anticipation by stakeholders of future implementation activities and also help in the orderly preparation for requirements like land use requirements, right-of-way, no, financing options, exploration of that and the structuring of that, the management of political interests, and the capacity building for implementers. It would be ideal for Congress to enact a long-term transport plan, pero habang wala pa, in the meantime, the prescribed principles in the existing NEDA Board issuance of the National Transport Policy can already be adopted, no? Although with a weaker enforcement power relative to a legislation. So that can be adopted by implementing agencies. No? Transparency in reporting to and discussions at interagency committees such as the NEDA Board Infracom and the Infracom Interagency Technical Committee on Transport Planning on non-compliance with the prescribed principles in the NTP may help enforcement in the meantime. So if there's documentation and that's always being talked about, no, there's transparency in reporting, candidness in discussion, that may help enforcement in the meantime. Now, given the Supreme Court ruling on the Mandanas-Garcia case and the devolution of projects, the national government must continue its capacity building programs for LGUs. So they will have a bigger mandate and there are many weaknesses in their capacities. At the same time, the completion and integration of Local roads databases must be fast-tracked kasi accurate information will be important in prioritizing areas of support. We also need to introduce transit-oriented development in cities outside Metro Manila through sustainable infrastructure, master planning, and giving budget for that. No? The failures in Metro Manila urban rail transport systems are sources of lessons for cities outside Metro Manila. And we think that performance audits of these systems and benchmarking with cities in other countries could reinforce the lessons. Okay, next slide, please. Now, with respect to the for later release funds problem, the issue is complex and it has deep political economy ramifications. Now, on one hand, meron tayong legislators who always find ways to insert new or expanded items in the budget. And on the other hand, the president could impose its will on legislators by having post-GAA procedures that could decide on the release of funds for congressional insertions on a case-by-case basis. So it seems to be a battle of wills between two major influences on project implementation. And the Filipino public is caught in between, no? So it's difficult, but we have to come up with recommendations, which are as follows, no? At the national level, seeking reform champions for minimizing congressional introductions and fast-tracking executive approvals is necessary. At the regional level, one solution that could be attempted is for government officials to strengthen the practice of project identification and prioritization at the Regional Development Council level or RDC. No? The tracking of how many and what percentage of RDC-endorsed projects make it to the GAA can be institutionalized. Having greater transparency in the accounting for and reporting of the RDC priorities, as well as readiness of the projects in the RDC list can also help. It's not part of our 2022 discussion paper, but I read yesterday, carefully yung GAA 2023 and the budget circular issued 2 weeks ago. And it states there that new programs, activities, projects not existing in the previous GAA is subject to the approval of the president. Yun yung nasa budget circular. And the release of funds under new items of appropriations requiring SARO is subject to the clearance or approval of the office of the president. So right now, we're crossing our fingers and sincerely hoping that these are not items considered congressional introductions na not yet implementation ready, or the office of the president may consider na still lacking in requirements. So we're hoping that the project these are really implementation ready. Okay, and next slide. And that wraps up our presentation. And for those who have not yet downloaded and read our discussion paper, I invite you to do so. Thank you for your attention.